Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown, because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive. Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section. I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess and join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Age of Radio.
Welcome back to National Geographic. This week we are examining the life cycle of the locust.
Yes, the locust, a creature that has been around for many, many years, they tend to travel in swarms.
As we can see shown here, a swarm of locusts are devouring an entire crop of wheat, which is not uncommon for the insect.
Now, they have been known to also cause pestilence because, they have an interesting occupation. Would you mind explaining to them what locusts are also up to these days?
Yes, locusts are also known to be the minions to do the bidding of the dark demon Pazuzu, a ruler of several sections of hell.
A kind of a fun name to say for a not-so-fun entity.
And as we can see here, there's several of them doing some pretty evil things. Here is a group forming a Ponzi scheme to steal money from the elderly.
Oh, dear. And they also seem to be gathering quite closely together. Let me just see if I can get a good read on those signs they have. They do appear to be pictures of dead babies.
And as we can see, A lot of red hats with not a lot of masks.
Not a lot of masks, a lot of red. Oh, and it looks like, yes, they are descending upon that government building, and they all are armed, of course.
One seems to be making off of the podium. One seems to have body painted themselves like Braveheart, but with a Loyal Order of Water Buffalo hat on.
And you know what? One of them, it just got too close to the sun. It looks like squish. Oh, but the locust does seem to be clinging on to life, and it seems to be wanting to say something.
Let's just get in and see if we can see what they're saying here.
Jewish space lasers. Marjorie Taylor Greene for president. Bleh.
Terrible.
You know when I pick up a beat, that's when I'm under pressure now. The question always comes back to me, what were they thinking now?
Oh, Well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to What Were They Thinking? A podcast about bad to questionable movies. I am your host, Nathan, and with me, as always, is the, Father Lamont to my Regan McNeil?
Sweet.
Brendan, introduce yourself there, fella.
Yeah, it's me, just priesting it up. Priest style.
At least that no one can say we're married.
No, but we do have a little bit of a scene together in this movie. I guess that's okay. Fake Reagan, but you know. I just thought about this now. Now, this movie is called Exorcist II Heretic, Heretic. I'm going to say Heretic a million times. I'm sorry. Not to bury the lead on what we're talking about, but I mean, we all saw the episode title. But my question is, if there was an exorcist, like, this feels like the title someone would make up if there was like an all-female reboot and someone was like, more like Exorcist Heretic. So woke of you. You know, that's
just. And then everybody in the world would be like, it's pronounced heretic, you idiot.
And they would say, I know I was making a point. And people would say, well, it was a stupid point.
And it was poorly made.
Yeah, Exorcist 2, Schlocktober Sequel continues. Sorry, Schlocktober Sequel Month continues, I should say.
Yes, yes, yes. And I'll give you the breakdown of the plot on this one, man. It's very convoluted, but also, you know, also very confusing. Mm. So, I mean, if at any point you guys are hearing stuff and you're like, oh, wait a second, I think one of them had a stroke, or possibly both of them. We did not. This movie is lunacy. But also, and I don't know how this happened, it's lunacy, but also exceedingly boring.
Very, very slow.
I nearly fell asleep a couple times watching this.
I started this at like 7 o'clock at night, and I was dozing, starting to doze at about 8:30. And I'm like, wait a second.
Yeah. Doesn't help that. Well, anyways, we'll get... Gonna do the plot so we can get into it and talk about all the boring parts and hopefully not put everybody to sleep. Okay, so this is a continuation of the original Exorcist. It picks up in
a classic film, by the way.
Yes,
a much better movie.
I think has one other good entry in the whole lot of them.
Yeah, apparently the third one's not bad.
Third one I hear is quite good. But that's not the one we're talking about. Mm-mm. Plot. Picks up in 1977, and the Vatican, or the Catholic Church in America, I guess, because they don't go to Rome, I don't believe. Anyways, they short and long of that is they need to investigate the actual exorcism that happened in the first one to see if it was legit, if everything was faked or anything like that. Our lead priest, Father Lamont, is then tasked to track down Regan. It's McNeil, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. And get her info and anybody else who may have been witness to the whole thing to find out if it's true. And, to see if the whole Pazuzu thing was real. It turns out it is. And there's all kinds of globetrotting and hilarity ensues.
Yeah, and isn't he also trying to figure out, like, isn't he also meant to investigate how Father Merrin died from the first one, too? And because they're not entirely sure if he, like, welcomed the demon in, or, you know, if Regan did something.
They're worried that he might have been possessed himself before he died or something.
Here's the thing. Like, having seen the first movie, like, it already came out, we know the answer to this mystery. Because he gets the demon out of Regan, it goes into him, and then he takes his own life to rid the demon, get rid of the demon, mm-hmm. sacrifices himself. So immediately, the mystery behind this is like, we already know, so it's like, it kind of takes a lot of the sting out of it from the get-go.
It does, but they kind of, I don't know, retcon or tiptoe their way kind of around it, but... We'll get to that. We open with an opening theme by, I'm assume, is performed by the love child of Yoko Ono and Buffy St. Marie.
Man,
because it was nothing but yips and yaps and weird off-key music.
There was like women screaming. There was like weird breathing. There was it was the most 70s thing I've heard in a while.
Okay.
Like it
I listened to a lot of Bob Marley, so that's not the most 70s thing I've heard in a while.
Well, there's a different subset of 70s music. Maybe not, you know, relaxing 70s music. But it did feel, this whole movie felt very, I mean, it was made in 1977, but it felt like the 70s to me the entire time. It's very 70s.
Yeah. We open with credits to see that everybody is in this movie, apparently.
Mm.
So we got James Earl Jones, Richard Burton, Linda Blair, had a couple other
legendary alcoholic here. Richard Burton. We've got Nurse Ratched herself,
yep.
Louise Fletcher. We've got Max von Sydow, although I question, I guess he's in some flashback scenes that weren't in the first one, but
yes.
He's not in it a whole lot. And we also have Ned Beatty, or how do you say
it? Yeah, for a cup of coffee, and somehow he gets this kind of billing.
I didn't even know who he played.
He was the airplane guy. Ecumenical Ed, I think he called himself.
That's it?
Yeah. Jesus. He's the dude who flies Richard Burton to go visit what he thinks is the village from Gymkhana.
Wow. Well, I'm sure he was glad he got Superman after this.
So when we actually do get to some scenes and stuff where we're opening, we meet our hero, Father Lamont, as he is being led to an exorcism. I guess it's an exorcism, because there's everyone's there, and this poor girl is screaming, you know, why I healed people, as she's also, you know, being very, I guess, Linda Blair-y from the first one.
Mm-hmm.
So much so that it turns out it ends up being a pyro show from a Rammstein concert, where she just like starts knocking candles and shit over and like just immolates.
The first of two immolations in this movie.
Yes, yes.
Also, the comedy's already working for me. Richard Burton as a priest? I mean, come on.
Yes, Martha. I'm sure I know what you're talking about.
I love, just because, like, he has this, Richard Burton has this look where as soon as I see him, I don't think to myself, oh, Father.
But sometimes, oh, Jesus. So this is all just to kind of set up what his situation is, and the fact that he's had experience with exorcisms and possessed people and stuff before. Because then we cut to what I think is it just a school or a center for helping folks with disabilities?
All I know is that it is the funkiest psychiatric institute I've ever seen.
Okay, because I thought it was a school for the deaf at first.
No, I think it's just like I assumed it was just a psychiatric ward for people who are, like, you know, dealing with one thing or another.
Well, it must be a treatment center, like, because it's they never truly make it out to, you know, what it is,
right?
Because Regan can come and go as she pleases. She has her own apartment, for lack of a better term.
Was she staying with someone though, right, who's like kind of looking after her?
Yes. Yeah. And but that was, I had questions about that whole relationship, but we'll get to that when we get to it. She's also doing like a dance recital rehearsal. Is that dance thing, is that part of the center, or is that separate? Because we do find out that she does go to school.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that this was like, this is part of her school. And then we see her having her therapy session at the funky clinic, as you so put it. So, is she going to a school for people with that, with like past issues, or is it a completely separate thing? Because we do see her actually perform this thing later, and her caretaker's there, but I didn't see if any of the other kids who were at the center with her were actually involved in the production as well.
See, I thought it was just a school thing, but I missed a bit of the I must have missed at the opening where she was practicing or forgot about it, because when it gets to that shot later where we just startling cut to her dancing with everyone on stage, I was like, what? Wait, hold on.
Where did this come from?
What's going on? So, yeah, I don't know. I feel like it's a school, but we don't ever see her going to school, do we?
We hear that she goes to school from her caretaker at one point.
So it must be her school, but it's just, you know, poorly presented.
Okay. Well, she's making kind of eyes at there's a kid playing saxophone, and she's kind of losing her concentration, but they kind of make eyes at each other, none of this matters because nothing comes of it.
Nope.
She does as her tap dancing gets better, and then we cut to her going to her therapy session. Hypnotherapy, actually.
Yeah, by the way, I hadn't seen this movie before. I think have you seen it once before?
I had seen it once late night in the late 80s.
Okay.
So I virtually had no memory of this movie. The only thing I remembered from this movie was the hypnotherapy stuff, and the fact that there was a conversation that Regan has about, because it was such a wild thing to say, I was possessed once, but I'm better now.
That's my favorite line in this movie. She says it so casually.
And that stuck with me.
Okay, because I was going to say, I not having seen this ever, not knowing anything about it, when she walks into the doctor's office and her therapist is fucking Nurse Ratched, I was like, oh, no.
She's at a psychiatric institute and Nurse Ratched's there.
Get away. As long as she doesn't try to start a vote on TV and baseball, she'll be fine.
We're all good then, eh? So she has her hypnotherapy session. Nothing really. It just kind of lets you know that this is what Reagan's doing. She's still getting help for the issues or that she had. I mean, if you can count issue like being possessed as an issue, it's not exactly acne or something.
It's like get over yourself, right?
Yeah, I was possessed. You're better now, though.
Oh, the devil was in my body and making me do straight up evil shit.
You know what? Here, it wasn't even the devil. It was just a lesser demon.
Yeah, Pazuzu. Like, who do you ever beat?
Exactly.
The hypnotherapy thing, it's not only just hypnotherapy, but it's they're
a dream sinker.
Yeah.
That's messed up. That's I don't think that's a thing.
Okay. I wrote down, there's no way this is a thing, because they put on these devices on their head. And I said in the theaters when people first saw this, because apparently people walked out yelling, angrily yelling about how much they hated this movie when it first started playing. This had to be the moment, because the for this fucking thing to show up and it's like, oh, really? This is how we're starting out the long-awaited sequel to The Exorcist by having a fucking mind melder? What is this shit?
Well, we have to let people know even though we're doing a mind meld dream sync thing, the church is involved. Remember there was that scene, and now we got to cut to Father Lamont being summoned to, I'm thinking it's it's not the Pope.
Yeah.
Because they mentioned the Pontiff later, because they even say they call him the Pontiff, not the Pope.
That would have been great if it was just the Pope. And he was like, I'm some tasking dude with a
Pope hat looking like fucking John Paul II.
Here's your mission. Should you choose to accept it? Here, take this pill. If you're discovered, swallow it.
Da-da-da-da.
Yeah, no, he basically tells him, all right, Father Lamont, you know how the opening scene where you sucked at exorcisms and that girl burst into flames? Well, now I want you to investigate the death of Father Merrin.
But he's buddies with this cardinal, though, too.
Yeah.
Because when they first meet, the cardinal being all oh, super serious, so you need to go to America and investigate. And then after, the underlings go, they're like, Bobby, Jimmy Pants, how you doing? I mean, I'm paraphrasing, but...
No, you're right. That's Jason Momoa was playing the cardinal.
My man!
Although he was three? If alive?
If alive, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he has to go and he has to investigate Marin's last exorcism. And We don't need to. Thank goodness we don't need to see him really flying to America or anything like that. We can do that later when people are on planes. We get hit. He gets to the Institute. So this is where our stories are gonna cross now.
Mm-hmm.
And he has like this kind of drawn out talk with Nurse Ratched about evil versus mental illness.
Yeah. Well, this movie makes it very clear, you know, which side is correct. Because Ratched is saying like, well, I think she's, you know, she's dealing with mental illness, which is what a rational person would say. Like,
yeah.
But then of course, you know, that's not this movie. So Lamont is like, no, she's dealing with evil. She was possessed by Pazuzu. We're fighting the devil.
And like I said, I don't really remember seeing this movie from when I saw it as a kid, but it actually kind of strikes me funny that this comes up because I've been watching this YouTuber lately who he basically kind of breaks down cults and Christian nationalist preachers and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And there's a couple of them who still hold this idea that things like schizophrenia and autism and borderline personality disorders, depression, those aren't mental illnesses. You're possessed by the demon of borderline personality. You're possessed by the demon of depression.
Yeah.
And that it can be exorcised from you by a minister. Not by going to therapy, you know, getting on the right medications, doing the steps and doing your best to get away from those behaviors. No. Just go to a tent revival and have somebody smack you on the forehead.
Yep, that's all it takes.
That's all it takes. we see Regan again with her caretaker Sharon.
Mm-hmm.
They're watching some, you know, thing that it was big in the 70s, the whole bending of spoons and mentalists thing. Regan shows that, oh, she can do it too, and she's tricking Sharon. Now, I think it's kind of mean for her to do this to Sharon, because from everything I can gather, Sharon was party to her being possessed.
I mean, she's not in the first movie, is she?
Even if she's not, she's been definitely filled in, and she's not the type to think that, you know, Reagan's mom was a liar. Also, their house looked like their house after the end of The Exorcist.
Yes,
and the Sharon, I believe, is a friend of Reagan's mom, because that's what they made it sound like.
That's what's called we can't get Ellen Burstyn for the sequel,
right? She's always traveling.
Yeah.
So for her to be like, you stupid idiot, you believe anything. Sweetheart, you are possessed by demons and she knows about it. Yes, she might believe in magic because she knows that there's something a little more than, you know, the regular world can explain.
Right. Is this when we go back to
That scene was where I thought they were a couple at first.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Well, because they don't say that she's her caretaker right away.
Yeah.
Right? They're just two women in a really nice-looking apartment having breakfast and watching television.
Well, and one of the subtly creepy things they do in this movie is Linda Blair was like 16, maybe 17 at the time, and they really adult
they
the shit out
They should have put
of
a
her.
Bra on her then.
I was just going to say, they adult the shit out of her. Like,
there were several times where it was like, this is the 70s and bras don't mean shit. Here are my nipples.
It was just like, yeah, it was just like, Jesus Christ. Like, this feels inappropriate given her age. Like, and also the fact that we're coming off of the first one where she's like a child. Like, it was only 3 years before this, but she changed a lot in 3 years. Like, in the first one, she looks like a little kid. In this one, you know. They're saying like they're making her look as old as
possible.
She's
on the cusp of adulthood, yes.
But it's like, especially later.
It's a good thing that, you know, that Hollywood changed and they don't do that sort of thing anymore.
No.
Just ask Millie Bobby Brown.
Never. Yeah, no. Yeah, she's definitely not dealing with anything like that.
No.
But yeah, isn't this where they go back to the strobe light therapy or like the hypnotherapy?
This is actually one of the first big scenes with it. I mean, we got a taste of it earlier. The first one's free, but now we have to pay for it.
We pay for it because it's like 20 minutes long.
It seems longer.
But I gotta say, I'm wondering if this wasn't a very difficult scene for Linda Blair to act in, because from what I've heard about her, you know, troubled youth, she was doing a lot of partying up at Studio 54. So the strobe light thing probably wasn't like a difficult thing to deal with.
No, nor zoning out like you're on some sort of drug as well.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, apparently she got arrested for cocaine, like trying to sell cocaine when she was like 18. Like she had a rough Hollywood childhood.
Any childhood in Hollywood's a rough childhood.
There's been a few exceptions, but yeah, for the most part.
There are exceptions. They're not the rule. That's for goddamn sure.
Mm-hmm.
The whole idea of the mind meld thing actually made me joke. Is she? She's not Nurse Ratched. She's clearly Dr. Spock.
Oh, the scene goes on for so long, and then Nurse Ratched gets like lost in the mind meld, and then Father Lamont, who's never done this before, has to go in. Yeah, he just, I'll go save her. What's this? I've never worn it before. Okay,
And that's the thing. He's never worn it. He's never done it before. And at one point during this thing, someone says, "Remember how this works?" No, he doesn't, because he's never done it before.
He's just spent like 5 minutes railing against science. Do you think he knows what this even is?
Exactly.
But he puts it on and he gets Nurse Ratched out after like, you know, I don't know, conservatively 3.5 hours.
Yeah, because it was at this point where I was like, holy, put the audience to sleep, because... That the slow flashing strobe along with,
listen to my voice, just listen to my voice, come down and listen to my voice.
Oh man, I nearly fell off the couch.
It was like not as sexy, but it was like that scene in Demolition Man where Stallone and Bullock have mind sex.
Kind of.
Not nearly as sexy as that though.
And so they're showing this, but they're showing like her having a hard time with what's going on in the dream and stuff like that, and she's reacting to it, but at this point we're not seeing anything, and I'm like, come on, just show us the flashback, like, yeah, show us stuff from the first movie or something so we get to see what they're experiencing. That's how movies work. Do they do that? No, kind of. We get a weird transparency effect that starts happening when Regan starts standing behind the doctor and she's reaching her hand over her chest in a weird way.
Yes.
So that Pazuzu can grab her other hand and show that they have Nurse Ratched's heart in her hand.
But what it looks like is Regan and Pazuzu grabbing Nurse Ratched's tits.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what it looks like.
It looks like the start of a different kind of movie. Like that Stepfather one that I watched. So, Father Lamont is supposed to be helping Nurse Ratched get out of the dream, and he doesn't do shit.
No.
And then they act like I'm so glad you were here to help, Father. He didn't do anything.
He doesn't even, again, he's never used this device.
So, while they have their little discussions, Regan goes out to mill about with the children who are there. And she's like, you know, being nice with the kids and having fun. And then she turns into a real jerk because she's like, oh, what would you like me to draw? And the kid's like, draw me a house. And she's like, no, I'm not drawing a house. Here, look, I'll draw this instead. It's like, just draw the kid a house, Regan. Don't be a dick.
And then she draws a picture of Lamont.
With fire around him.
And it's the craziest, sequence of events, because Lamont looks at it and he's like, flames, flames, we've got to put the fire out. And I'm like, what?
Fire, the flames are getting bigger.
We got to put the fire out. We got to put the flames out. And then cut suddenly that there's like a room on fire somewhere. And I'm like,
well, he figures that he's going around the building. He's looking for it. And he goes down into like this boiler room, basement type area. And that's where he finds this box of stuff on fire. had they gone out of their way to see, to show us that he had some sort of ability for premonition, okay, sure. Or, because I think they do explain it away that it was because he did the mind meld thing that he could kind of breathe, he could see, he could divinate and see, like, I don't know, prophecy or something.
Mm-hmm.
Have him see the stuff. Show us seeing him see it in his head.
Yeah, it was explained.
At the very least.
It was explained very poorly.
No, he just wanders around saying, the flames are getting bigger, we have to put them out. And he's just randomly looking for doors until he finds a thing that's on fire somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you know what would have been better? Showing him seeing flashes of imagery of the room that the fire is in. So he could figure out what room it's in. So it doesn't make it look absolutely ridiculous that he's just randomly opening doors trying to find fire.
Yeah, that scene was, that's again, it was just the connective tissue. I was like, what is going on?
So they find the fire, and he attacks it with a crutch and just starts beating it, so it spreads the fire even more. Dr. Nurse Ratchet goes and gets the fire extinguisher, and as she's coming back, she sees the flames all around Father Lamont, just like Regan's picture.
Whoa.
Dun, dun, dun.
And then Lamont is like, well, the only solution right now is that I need to sync up with Regan's brain, and Nurse Ratchet, you stand by, control the tempo, so we can find out what's going on with this whole, Pazuzu Marin thing, okay, babe?
Yeah, so he goes, so Dennis, he goes away from...
Yeah. What happened? Tell me, babe.
Well, he starts out hating the machine, uh-huh. And now Father Lamont loves the machine.
Uh-huh. Well, that's what happened with Bordello of Blood, babe. I didn't like the script, but I liked the money. Cha, cha, cha.
Yeah. Dump truck full of money.
Anyway, gotta go.
Goodbye. You're never welcome back here.
Cha, cha, cha.
This movie, and another thing, too, this movie talks about astral projection.
Yes.
As well. Which is another thing I found out that people still kind of think is a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because I saw a YouTube video about a preacher, the same YouTuber, examining these nutter butter ministers. One of them was talking about how witches in Africa would astral project themselves over missionary planes in Africa and pee on the crowds below. And then they would chant Bible verses, and the witch's body would catch up with her spirit, and they would fall out of the sky buck naked.
That sounds like it would work, yeah.
In 2022.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the science checks out.
Nutter butters. Anyhow, so they start kind of talking about astral projection, and because Regan starts talking about how she could see like Africa and the locusts and all that, and the Father Lamont is also experiencing these things too, because this is where we're seeing Father Merrin kind of reemerge for the first time, because we're seeing flashes of him performing exorcisms in Saharan Africa, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Did they actually say, was it in Nairobi? I can't remember what country, what
no,
it was.
No, I'm pretty sure this movie just says Africa.
Okay.
I think according to the movie, it sounds pretty much like Africa's a country. they show, like, once they start mind-melding, don't they show, like, locusts attacking, like, a tribe? That's in Regan's mind, right? And she's like restless and moving around, and then she walks right up to the edge of a balcony and nearly jumps.
That seems like a poor design flaw.
Why would you put someone who was possessed by a demon?
Let's go back even further. Why would you build a balcony on a skyscraper that high and leave giant gaps that you could walk out of?
Yeah, well, yes, exactly. A big design flaw. But also, don't put someone who's prone to self-harm and demonic possession in that apartment. Also, she also has free access to the roof, which I also question the logic of. Don't let her on the roof.
But again, she hasn't had any issues of of self-harm since the possession.
But I mean, I'm just going to say this. If you were once possessed by a demon, I feel like it's good to just keep a close eye on it for a few years. I think it's okay to have your guard up just a little bit.
Well, by the looks of her, the way they portray her in this movie, it's been at least 15 years since the first movie.
Good Christ.
Because she's walking out in like this, in a nightgown that I can only describe as something that the late, great Angela Lansbury would have worn in one of her, you know, sultrier days.
Or like something where the producers are like, well, it's literally the least we can do and not get arrested.
So throw that on her. No bra, but make sure she's got some underpants on.
Right. Oh, God. John Boorman likes his stars to be in underpants. Look at Zardoz and Sean Connery's wearing a big diaper.
It's fair. It's fair. She doesn't fall off the building, though. She does scream just as she's about to. This alerts her caretaker, Charlotte, to what's going on.
Sharon.
And she runs out, and Regan plays it off like she was just outside feeding the doves, because they keep doves in a birdhouse designed by fucking, I don't know, Frank Lloyd Wright. It's a weird looking birdhouse.
Whoever it was, they designed it on under heavy use of drugs. Also,
so in the 70s.
Yes, everyone designed everything under heavy use of drugs. But also, then when they cut back to, and this movie is as slow and meandering as it sounds, people. But they cut to like a scene later where Ratchet is talking with Laurent again, and we find out that Ratchet is a divorcee. And I wrote down, oh, Lamont must think her a greater devil than Pazuzu at this point.
Yeah. And wasn't there a locust spy here at one point where it made it look like there was like a locust that was just watching everything?
Oh, really?
Spying on all the stuff.
What's watching them?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
A giant, because every once in a while there'll be this just this giant locust the camera will cut to, and it's like, I don't speak locust, so and some subtitles would have been helpful.
Oh yeah,
I mean, I managed to stumble through the French because I got that, and even the Spanish at the first, I know what's going on here, but when they got, I'm not up to speed on my locust dialect, so I was totally lost. Every time this thing showed up, it was like...
Do you think they ever stopped filming for like a second and just looked at each other and they were like, you guys know we're supposed to be making an Exorcist 2, right? Like, this is supposed to be like the
Plagues
Exorcist.
Plagues of Egypt, man. Plagues of Egypt.
Because we're going to Africa a lot, I'm just saying. We're going... And I mean, we're going to have a whole scene with Father Merrin in Africa treating this boy. Okay, guys. Listen, I'm just the caterer. I'm just asking.
We do find out that Pazuzu actually had fear of Father Merrin, because when they do one of the cuts to Africa, he encounters Pazuzu for the first time.
It's because he blessed the rains.
Exactly. Sure as Kilimanjaro rises among the Sering. How's that fucking thing go?
I don't know. I just know they bless the rains down in Africa. That's about it.
As sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti.
The definitive Weezer song.
Oh... Anyhow, so yeah, Dr. Mom is divorced, and they're having this kind of discussion, and Regan just pops in, telling secrets?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mostly about you, but also about Dr. Mom here, who's divorced.
Yeah.
And they do another hypno machine.
Yeah, and don't we learn there was like, okay, there was like a boy in Africa. Again, they don't name
this
the country.
This is where we get like the full... Max von Sydow experience in Africa.
My favorite Disney park ride, by the way.
I tried to get on, but I didn't book the express pass with enough advance. Apparently they open the express pass for the day that you're gonna be at Disney like in February. And if I'd known that, I would have booked my Max von Sydow in Africa experience in February before we went in April that year.
What's funny is that sometimes it's different Max von Sydow characters. So, like, sometimes it's his character from Minority Report. Sometimes it's from The Exorcist. Sometimes it's the flashback from Exorcist II, Heretic.
I was crossing my fingers that it was going to be The Needful Things Max von Sydow.
Oh.
Or at the very least, Judge Dredd.
Right. Right.
Yeah. So, yeah, he meets... what the heck? Kakuma, that's the young lad's name, who we find out through this flashback that he was a village healer, but he was also possessed. We get the full shot of the locust doing the attack on the village,
yeah.
And him and the rest of the village out there. I don't know, they were swinging like blades on, I'm assuming it was to drive away the locusts to calm them down or to make them kind of divert their path.
Yeah.
It
was like a stick with like a rock on a rope or something.
Yeah, yeah. I've seen it done in like other movies and nature specials and stuff before. I don't know exactly the science or the belief behind it.
Mm-hmm.
But later in the movie, somebody does it with no rock stick or anything like that, and I'm like, that's just stupid.
By the way, his name is Kakumo, and maybe this just says something about me, but every time I heard his name, that's where I want to go.
That's Kokomo.
I know.
And someone actually calls him that later in the movie.
Yeah. Well, that's what I thought I heard at first, and I was like, is his fucking name Kokomo?
So we're getting all of this, and Father Lamont is kind of experiencing all this stuff, too, as it's going on. We see him trying to traverse this terrible climb to this terribly like located church or shrine.
Oh,
where
yeah.
People have to like, you know, inch their way up between two rock walls and then, you know, freehanded. And poor Homer Simpson falls down the gorge several times to his death during this flashback. We get there. They got this rocking like Jesus shredded curtain thing going on, and you know what, I always heard that in real estate the first three rules is location.
Mm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't feel that they abided by that one in this. I feel that this was a poor choice. I can't see there being a good turnout for collection plates on Sunday at this church.
No, I agree. It kind of reminded me of where I used to live, and I had to climb all those steps to get home every time.
And you had to, like, you know, inch back up, put your feet up on one wall, put your back up another, and shimmy your way up to get your groceries into your apartment?
Yeah. Like, eventually, I just built, like, a pulley system.
Okay. Well, that makes sense, yeah. Because they do that for one person at this shrine later, but not for anybody else, apparently. I'll say this also about this whole section, because we get more of the opening song composition. Fuck the sound design in this movie. Yeah.
If I was a real bastard, I would just end the episode with that music.
And we get some weird, like, dream stuff, because, again, remember, this is all happening in a dream. Some weird flash-forward stuff where they fly from there to another section, and James Earl Jones is there fighting a jaguar.
Mm-hmm.
End of dream.
Yep. Good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Good stuff. And this is the next section here is where Regan has the conversation with the poor autistic girl. And the girl has never apparently talked and starts talking to Regan. And one of the first things Regan says to her was, I was possessed, but I'm much better now.
Again, yeah. My favorite part. Also, like, I thought when they said she was autistic, I was like, I don't feel like they I'm not saying this isn't, like, a thing that, you know, can happen, but I don't feel like they got the mental illness 100% correct here.
No, but, well, they didn't maybe necessarily get it 100% correct here. But the idea we find out is that this girl was nonverbal.
Right.
Which that's a much, you know, a much higher end on that spectrum. So, like, if a kid's nonverbal, I think at that point, because if autism would been recognized at that point as an actual, you know, condition, that's one of the things that would make people say, sit up and say, oh yeah, that's definitely it. Mm-hmm. As opposed to now where we see it as it's a spectrum where it can be as low as, you know, like OCD and tics and things like that, all the way up to, you know, nonverbal, heart, you know, non-communicative things like that. But I think at this point, if anybody was going to be recognized as autistic at this point in time, they would have had to at least be nonverbal, which this little girl was, because Regan says, I heard her talking on the inside, then she started talking on the outside.
Yeah, and
I don't know where she got that southern accent from.
Actually, you know, it's funny you joke, but I'm pretty sure I heard it come up a couple times.
No, it did. Yeah, this scene, she actually says that. I heard her talking on the inside, then on the outside.
But Pazuzu left a little accent dust when he left. I thought it was, because in this scene, we kind of figure out that she can do that mind melt shit without using a machine. So I was like, was she doing it early? Why did she need it earlier then?
Well, and this is what leads Father Lamont to think that there's a, like, Pazuzu is, there's still part of Pazuzu inside of her because she's able to do this sort of thing.
Right.
And, like, the mom is overjoyed, and rightfully so. I mean, if you had a kid, the kid looked like, I think the kid was supposed to be, like, 8 or 9 or something.
Mm-hmm.
Never talked a day in her life, and all of a sudden starts talking. I would be a weepy mess on the floor.
Yeah, for sure.
So
there's a weird conversation here where she asks if priests believe in ESP, and he goes on and on about how one day we're all going to develop this world mind.
Oh, he starts talking about the singularity. Yeah.
Jesus.
He also talks about how we could go one way or the other. We could become the singularity. You know, pointed in the direction of God, or we could be the singularity pointed in the direction of Satan.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of, I don't know a lot about religion. I'll be the first to admit that. But apparently, according to the stuff that I've read, there's a lot of, like, religious theories and stuff in here that are, like, picked here and there from, like, different things and mixed and matched, and so it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense when they're all put together. Like they take from Christianity, they take from, like, you know, Muslim, whatever, and they just kind of, like, all jumble it together. So not only are you getting, like, a bland but crazy movie, you're also getting super, like, inaccurate, we didn't even bother to do any research kind of movie.
Well, and that's a, I mean, that's a thing too, because it, but this, you know, most people pick and choose regardless. And I've seen people who will talk about how important it is to love your neighbor and be like Jesus and give to the poor and things like that. Meanwhile, you know, next week, it's, you know, I don't want that, I don't want that, you know, that halfway house, you know, in my neighborhood.
Mm.
You're kind of sending out two messages here. So.
Yeah, love thy neighbor and build that wall.
Exactly. Yes.
So doesn't he find Kokumo at this point?
Well, he finds out
that's Kokumo's where he wants name. To go.
And he wants to go to find him.
Yes.
So he goes to see his buddy, Jimmy Pants, the guy who's a cardinal. And he's like, you know, I want to go to... He's trying to scam a free trip to Africa, essentially, out of the cardinal.
Are you saying that Kokumo is where he wants to go?
Yes.
That's where he wants to go?
Way down with Kokumo.
Okay. Yeah. Just making sure.
Yeah. And if he has the chance, he will actually bless the rains down in Africa, because he is a priest.
Yes.
And has the ability to do that.
Correct.
But the cardinal, I'm just saying cardinal now because I know it's not the Pope, and that's the best I can do. The cardinal's not having it. He goes all like, "You're off the case, Lamont. You're a loose cannon. Hand in your gun and your rosary."
Yeah. Not my precinct.
So, priest sank.
Oh, shit.
Oh, hey. Dad joke. Thank you.
You're running hot under the collar.
I'll excommunicate your ass so fast. Yeah, so not having it, he basically says he has to take a sabbatical or a you know, time off. He's like, you can't go do it. And, but Father Lamont's like, nuts to that. I'm a rogue priest who plays by his own rules. I'm getting on that plane, whether you like it or not.
Lone wolf.
Because if I don't, I'm going there. Because if I don't, I'll regret it. Maybe not today. Maybe not tomorrow. But soon, and for the rest of my life.
That's exactly what he says.
And then
he just goes. He just goes. And then Ingrid Bergman gets on the plane. It's very foggy.
And then Regan and Sharon say, you know, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship. And they start making out because I'm still pretty sure they're kind of a couple.
That's her mom's friend.
You know what? I've seen movies. Like Stepfather 2, not the one I was supposed to watch, but...
Right.
Where, you're my mom's friend. It's okay, we won't tell her.
I was going to come up with a different subtitle for that, and then I realized Make Room for Daddy still works.
Still works, yeah. So he just goes, and he does the whole thing where he goes up that... scales that mountain shimmy thing to get to the top... where he is greeted by some guy yelling at him and then going to take a bath with four young boys. That was disturbing.
That was weird. Yeah.
He goes in to take communion and just chugs the communion wine.
Well, I mean,
I thought that was hilarious. I would love to see that happen.
I mean, it's Richard Burton.
Well, that's fair. Like, I guarantee if that was an ad lib that they just left in.
I was gonna say, do you think they filmed that scene or that was just him like on break, just taking it?
Give me that blood of Christ. yes, thank you, Martha.
Mr. Burton, we have to film the scene where you assault Pazuzu next. Oh, good, I'm Randy.
That's fine. Can I pretend it's Elizabeth?
I miss her so much. How did I give that up?
Luckily, we'll get married three more times. So yeah, he chugs the communion wine, and they're... He has this whole discussion with the abbot, which I was like, man, missed opportunity. That he said he needed to talk to the abbot, that someone did not say, hey, abbot!
They just did a whole comedy routine right in the middle of it, yeah.
Right. The abbot gets all, you know, I don't want to talk to you because you mentioned Kakuma's name. Mm-hmm. So he thinks he's a devil worshiper and doesn't want anything to do with it. And they tell him the story about what happened with Father Merrin and the guy who fell to his death and they never found him. Mm-hmm. So he's like, oh, I'll prove I'm not a devil worshiper. I'll show you where he is. And he climbs down the thing. And it's at this point we see them get the abbot into like a little hand elevator and lower him down. I'm like, guys, I mean, come on. You couldn't do that for other people. You couldn't have like 3, 4, or 5 of those things set up.
Yeah, they didn't do it for Costello, but Abbott gets the royal treatment.
He just climbs on down, and he finds the body, and they ask him like how he figured it out, and he just kind of like says, "I saw it when I flew here in a trance," and I'm like, "Oh, that old story." But he brings that up again later because we cut back to Regan at the school. doing her little dance routine.
A jarring cut. We find out,
what's that?
A very jarring cut.
Very. But they do it to show that her and Father Lamont are apparently now Corsican twins.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they got a real, it's a real Dragonheart situation.
Yeah, if he gets hurt, she feels it. And she falls off the stage. And it seems, for something that they actually never use, I think, again, it seems a very pointless thing to do.
There's so much of this movie, though, where things get introduced, where things get talked about and are either dropped or barely utilized. And I'm like, this just feels like, it just feels like their homework assignment was, it has to be 117 minutes. Don't care what you need to do to get there, but it's gotta be.
Fill it. Yeah. she gets kind of, I guess, taken away after she passes out at her dance recital. And when she wakes up in the center, again, there's all these beds in these rooms that weren't there before. So is it a place like where the kids, there's other kids that like that live there too? And they're apparently not big on privacy because their idea of making things private is two-way glass.
Everywhere. The whole building is that.
Yeah.
That's why I was like, that. I honestly, when I first saw that building, I thought, does this take place like in like a futuristic timeline? Because it looks like it just, like, why would you design this building like that? Actually, you know what? It's the second building where the architect was super high on cocaine. Like, what? Who made these buildings?
Frank Lloyd Wright.
Oh, okay.
So after they kind of examine her and stuff, they want to sedate her so she can sleep, and she utters the lines, "Please don't drug me," to which I noted, that makes one of us. Father Lamont is now trying to figure out how he's going to get to see Kakumo, and they managed to arrange something, and it ends up with Ned Beatty landing a plane on a beach. Yes.
Yeah.
Ned Beatty lands a plane on a beach.
And a bunch of nuns run over, and I was like, oh, please tell me they're going to fly that plane. Sadly, no.
Flying nuns, no. This is Ecumenical Ed, as he calls himself. And, you know, he's gonna take Father Lamont to go see Kakumo. And that's kind of the beginning and the end of him in this movie, because he takes him to Kakumo. While they're flying it, they're flying through the valleys, the same valley that that Father Lamont had seen in the dreams. And he says to Ed, "I've flown here once before in a dream on a locust." And I'm like, dude, shut up. I don't care how much your belief systems... Normal people hear that and they think, you know what? As soon as I'm landing, I'm alerting the authorities because he is insane.
I would have loved if Ned Beatty at that point had been like, okay, and just put on a parachute and jumped out.
Because I think he actually says he flew there on the wings of a demon.
Yeah.
Which is lunacy.
Which is, you know, a totally standard casual thing to say to this guy you met 3 minutes ago.
Yeah, which it stands to reason because he dropped him off in what I thought was the village from Gymkhana.
Thankfully, in this movie, though, Ned Beatty doesn't fall for the "I think I'm going to be sick" routine, though.
Well, there is that, because then he would have been pushed out of a plane.
He was pushing up daisies.
Okay, so Father Lamont arrives in this village where Kakumo is supposed to be, and he talks to a fella. "I'm looking for a guy named Kakumo. Do you know where he is?" The guy says, "Kokomo." "No, Kokomo? Oh, no, Kokomo." I'm like, he didn't say Kokomo. He said Kakumo. Why do you keep saying Kokomo?
He's like, not my favorite Beach Boys song.
it's no Little Deuce Coupe.
Yeah, more of a California Girls.
Yeah. So he's like, okay, sorry to bother you. And then he goes and he finds somebody who takes him what he thinks is going to be the place he needs to be. But apparently they thought he wanted a wife and or a hooker. because they just bring out this bare-breasted woman who's all oiled up. Hey, nice girl, you like? And he's like, I'm a priest. I must resist the temptations.
But you know, Richard Burton was like, can we have a cut? Yes, I would like this. Yes.
Yes, if she could, if I could meet her in my dressing room.
You are of age, yes. Well, you know what? It's 1977. No one cares.
As long as you let me call you Lizzie while we do it. I miss her so.
Do you mind if I drink this entire bottle of tequila?
It doesn't matter if you mind at all.
I'm going to do it anyway.
I'm Richard Goddamn Burton.
I was the narrator in Zulu. I think I was. Maybe it was Richard Harris. I'm drunk.
Oh my god. So anyhow, so he goes away from there, and he's searching around the building, or not the building, but the village, looking for Kakumo, saying to God, I trust in you. I haven't called on Pazuzu. I need your help. Please show me. And then Regan or Pazuzu astral projects to his brain in Africa and makes him ask Pazuzu for help. And then immediately Pazuzu shows him where Kakumo is, and James Earl Jones is dressed as Saba Simba. It's fucked.
Yep. Meteor Man's James Earl Jones.
Yes. Meteor Man's James Earl Jones.
That's what all the kids know him from.
Yeah.
Also, Mariah was like not really watching this with me, but she was sitting in the room. And as soon as he spoke, she kind of perked up because obviously, you know, it's James Earl Jones.
Yep.
And she was like, wait a second. I was like, yes, Mariah, that is Darth Vader in full African tribesman gear. I would have loved, by the way, if Roddy Piper had just shown up. I'd be like, that's James Earl Jones. Come on. Why did he kill that Saba Simba gimmick right out of the bat? Right off that. That's something that confuses me to this day, but it's still.
Because he's Roddy fucking Piper.
Yeah, just like him on commentary saying, that's Tony Atlas. Because also, it was a recorded show. They could have just cut that.
They could have just cut it and said, we're not using it. Say the line like we're telling you, Roddy.
Anyway, wrestling reference got it in.
Yeah. So, okay, so he has, Father Lamont has this kind of discussion of faith with Kakumo, and basically saying, you've turned your back on God, you asked for help, and yada, yada, yada. He's like, no, I do. So prove it. And he makes him go to walk across this, like, I don't know, this floor of spikes that's slightly covered in water. Richard Burton steps on them. His feet are shredded in one of the only really gory scenes in the entire movie, quote unquote.
Mm.
And then he falls forward and Kakumo's there and he's a doctor, which is exactly how they should have just started out.
It's so...
Because the other stuff was super offensive.
Yeah. When he showed up in full African tribes and stuff, I was like, yikes.
Yeah.
But like, well, like, I think everybody he runs into in Africa has like the most stereotypical, you know.
Oh yeah, all the tribe stuff, the yeah. people that he meets earlier, all the dreams and stuff that he has, it's all like straight out of like a 1950s headhunters movie.
Oh yeah, it's like your favorite phrase, it's yikes on bikes all over the
yikes
place.
Yikes on bikes, there you go. But no, Dr. James Earl Jones, or Dr. Kakumo, is apparently an entomologist studying locusts.
Yeah.
And he's got like a PhD and a lab coat and everything, which I got to say for this movie, that's the kind of the biggest swerve in the entire thing, that they actually, you know, treated this character with like a dignity, with the ability that he's able to become a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And we find out that they've been studying how, you know, how grasshoppers kind of become locusts. It has to do with, you know, you know, like a hive mind or a swarm mind. So they go from being just an individual happy-go-lucky grasshopper, as he puts it, to an incensed swarm of locusts that just will devour any crop in sight.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's kind of a National Geographic special right in the middle of the movie. And after we get all that explanation, how we have, there's like this one type of grasshopper slash locust that they're trying to breed so that she actually becomes a calming agent in a swarm of locusts to calm the swarm down and get them all back to being grasshoppers again. It's the only bit of foreshadowing that actually pays off in any sort of way whatsoever later in the movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then we go back home.
Like you said, though,
back to America.
It did feel weird that we were just learning like facts about locusts for like 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, cool, but what does this have to do with anything?
Well, unlike most the rest of the stuff in the movie that doesn't pay off, this actually does.
Well, I should say most of it didn't have anything to do with anything.
Yeah. So he's going back home, and Regan actually kind of dips out. She steals the machine, the mind-melding machine.
Which, again, she doesn't need. We've established that.
Right, but she does. Takes off. Father Lamont goes to Sharon's place to see, you know, hey, can I talk to Regan? She has an absolute shit fit. Tells him to leave. Just beat feet. We don't want to see you again. Dr. Mom is trying to have her weekend at home with her kids, and she's already said how hard it is to do stuff, you know, with her kids. But no, now she's got to go and find Regan, I guess. And Dr. Lamont, or Father Lamont's back in town. And it's just, for a movie that had nothing hardly going on at any point in any scene going up, like just dragging at a glacial pace, to suddenly pack all of this stuff in the last act, it was, I almost got whiplash.
Yeah, because it's like oh, we'll save him with the end, and it's like it's just been
too much of a shift from the pace that you've been going along with.
Right, I almost would have respected it more if it had just kept up with that pace the entire time.
Yeah, a slow burn to a satisfying conclusion with an exorcism. But no, Reagan's got to steal some stuff, and then she's got to meet up with Father Lamont, and then Sharon and Dr. Nurse Ratchet's got to go looking for Regan. All this is stuff, and all that happened at the same time. She instinctively goes to the Natural History Museum, where she meets up with Father Lamont, because that was a scene that they had earlier, and they go to like some seedy hotel so they can do this dream sinking thing. And it's the unsanctioned mind meld. Let's just get to that, because
mm-hmm.
that's where the real beginning of this climax, culmination, whatever you want to call it, happens. Father goes into a trance, and Regan slash Pazuzu, they sync up, and then Pazuzu possesses Father Lamont, sort of,
yeah. It's, well, and because he won't say anything, so Regan like follows him. They get on a train.
She makes a phone call in a phone booth.
Yeah,
which is a very 70s thing to do.
Right,
and they tell her, don't go with him, because he's going back to Washington, where Regan, like back to Reagan's house where all the original exorcism with Father Merrin took place. She manages to get a hold of Dr. Nurse Ratchet, who says, don't go home, you know, stay where you are, you're in great danger, don't go home. And she's like, no, I got it, okay, thanks, bye, click, and then goes and gets on the Amtrak with him again. Escape with Amtrak.
Yeah. Again, thank you, Joe Biden. You continue to help formerly possessed little girls save their priests.
Who are currently kind of possessed. So everybody at this point now is making their way to D.C. Regan and, Father Lamont are on the train. Sharon and Dr. Nurse Ratchet are getting a taxi that's going to get them onto a plane.
And they, by the way, they do one of my favorite movie things, is they get into a cab and they're like, follow that car.
On the train, the ticket taker is coming along, and Reagan's like rummaging through the Father Lamont's jacket looking for a wallet so they can pay for tickets on the train. The guy's like, I'm gonna take you away. And he's like, no, I'm with him, I'm traveling with him, he's sick. And he just turns to the ticket taker. He's like, she belongs to me.
And he's like, cool.
Cool. It's the 70s, whatever. Just give me your money for your tickets.
Yeah, it's totally normal for a priest to just turn around and say, that 17-year-old girl belongs to me. Not like, you know, she's my daughter. Not like I'm taking care of her. No, she belongs to me. I have possession over her.
Right. Well, something has possession over me.
Maybe that was Pazuzu getting in a little zinger.
There you go. whilst also almost causing a plane crash.
Yeah, like he does.
We get some turbulence, but luckily Sharon and Nurse Ratched are fine when they get to DC. And then, of course, the whole follow that car.
I love when I think they say follow that bus, right? Because Lamont and
yes, they Reagan do get on the bus. Yeah, because they get on the bus,
and Lamont is a real Karen to that bus driver. He's like, this bus driver, the poor driver, sitting there eating his fucking Subway sandwich, and Lamont is like, can't you go now? We have to get to the house. And he's like,
you know what? Cool. But to the bus driver or the extra playing that bus driver, he really committed to the character, because that bus driver would be in the union and he'd be like, this is my lunch. And he keeps eating his sandwich.
No, he doesn't. He drives.
I thought he like took another couple bites out of his sandwich.
Oh, he did. But like, he pretty much like gets going. And I'm like, wait a second. Inaccurate, because bus drivers would also be on like a schedule. So they know when they can leave. And he knows he has time budgeted to eat his sandwich. So, sir, you can sit the fuck down.
Oh, no. You know what? They don't say follow that bus. They get in and they actually give give the cabbie the address, because he says 8 Prospect Street. Like, apparently it's like everybody knows what happened there.
I thought he was just it was just a really obvious bit of fan service to me, because I live close to Prospect Street.
No. Nothing to do with Fredericton whatsoever.
Oh, okay. So now people will know where I live.
They've known for quite some time, actually.
No, I just mean now they know I'm close to Prospect Street. Ooh.
Father Lamont and Reagan, they make it to Reagan's old place. They're kind of creeping around. It's not in the best of shape, because, I mean, you know, a priest flew out a window at one point.
But it's still there.
It's still there. For some reason. They open a closet, and just a swarm of locusts come flying out and apparently just descend upon the cab and cause the cab to crash.
But not before, I swear I saw this happen, but not before the cab driver punches a hole through his own windshield.
Oh, that comes after, because the locusts, they swarm the cab and they're hitting the cab with such force. I didn't know locusts were that big and had that kind of mass. Start breaking the windshield, and he has to fucking full-on punch a hole through his windshield so he can see.
With his bare hand.
Yes. And he still crashes.
His hand would be like just red. Like there would be.
You know what? That's the kind of toughness you have to have when you drive for DC cab.
Well, maybe he was a New York cab and he moved recently.
Eh?
Oh,
DC cab?
Yeah.
Mr. T.
I pity the fool.
they're back inside Reagan's old place, and one of the first things I noticed was that Reagan's mother's carpet runners were still there, and I was like, those goddamn things. Born in the 70s, raised in the 80s, my parents had those fucking plastic carpet runners. I don't know why they had them. The idea, I'm guessing, was to prevent wear and tear on the carpet.
Mm-hmm.
But if you ever mistakenly like popped one, like caught the end of it and it popped up and you stepped on the other side of the carpet runner barefoot or just in your sock feet, little spikes go into your feet. It's like Father Lamont earlier when he was meeting Kakumo dressed as Saba Simba.
I'm actually shocked that they went in there without vomiting from the smell of that carpet. If anyone remembers the first movie, I mean, she did some business on that carpet.
She did. But I'm guessing that they would have, had it cleaned at some
maybe
point.
I don't know if that was their top priority though during that movie.
I mean, afterwards
I'm about to exorcise the Stephen. Hold on, Father. Do you smell that?
It's like, I need to get the Regina cleaner, start carpet cleaner. There you go.
Just give me a second. No, no. Don't start the exorcism. We need to let this sit.
We need to get the rug shampooer out.
Don't worry. I got a rope around her ankle. She ain't going anywhere.
That's another thing my parents used to do, they shampoo the carpets.
Oh, for a second, I thought you were going to say, another thing my parents used to tie a rope around my ankle.
No, 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 no. That was my little brother.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
So.
So the cab driver's dead.
He's dead. And Sharon is she kind of possessed too at this point?
Yeah, she gets a little pazuzu in her because at first, here's the thing though. She's staring at Nurse Ratched. Now, I thought, and you see the gasoline coming out of the car, the fuel, I thought she was going to light it to kill Nurse Ratched. But no, she drops it and immolates herself, second time of the movie that this happens.
She steps on a light bulb, isn't it?
Oh, like, yeah. It's the popping
light bulb that causes a spark.
She smashes a headlight of the car.
That's it.
And it falls into the gasoline, and then she immediately ignites. But I swear I thought for a second she was going to kill Ratched. In fact, I thought it was weird that she possessed Sharon to kill herself. Anyway, whatever. But Sharon, I mean, spoiler alert for like 5 minutes later, but she's definitely burnt to a crisp and dead.
Yeah. We go back inside where Pazuzu is apparently there in corporeal form in Reagan's old bed. And Reagan, the real Reagan, is trying to persuade Father Lamont to not go to Pazuzu Reagan. And the line... What is it? I have it written down here. Let me find it. Pazuzu's Reagan is the only Reagan.
And Lamont not only goes to her, but he's sexually into it.
Like full on making out with her and stuff.
And again.
And then they're trying to get him to remember.
And again, 17-year-old Linda Blair.
Yeah. So they're trying to bring Father Lamont out of this. Sharon again is a crispy critter, as we see again. And my next note is, what the hell is this? Because there's a giant locust swarm that happens, and the fucking house starts to crack and break open. It's like, look, I appreciate that you want an exciting and a real audience grabbing climax, but you don't literally need to bring down the house. Because the house starts cracking and breaking in like several spots, mm-hmm. like pulling apart from the walls. People like Reagan's like falling down through one of the cracks to the next level below her with all this. And Father Lamont has to literally tear the heart out of Pazuzu Reagan.
Which is, again, I don't remember if we actually see it a lot here, but maybe the only other little tiny bit of gore/blood.
Oh, yeah, we do. Yeah, we do see that because we see him kind of like reaching into her chest cavity to get to the heart.
Which, to be fair.
To be fair?
To be fair. I don't think the first one was like overly bloody or gory either, but the first one is interesting.
Except for the turning of the head, the pea soup, and the masturbating with the crucifix.
Right. It's definitely startling. But
yes.
The first one, though, there's the difference is it grips you from minute one to the end. Like you're into it the whole time. This one, there's nothing to grasp. And
just throw everything at you here.
Yeah. It's the driest rated R movie I've ever seen. Well, one of them.
Yeah. It's at this point when Reagan, the real Reagan, because the Pazuzu Reagan's, essentially dead now, having the heart ripped out, she starts swinging her arms like the young version of Kakuma was doing, trying to ward off the locust. But she doesn't have the apparatus, the string with the rock or the blade or whatever it was attached that Kakuma was swinging around earlier. She's just swinging her hand around wildly in the air, but apparently that's enough. She is now the calming grasshopper that gets all the locusts back to being happy-go-lucky grasshoppers.
Ugh, whatever. It's
the only bit of foreshadowing that paid off in this movie.
Literally the only bit.
Yeah. And then they just kind of like whoosh, they go.
And as Sharon lays there, a charred corpse about to die, saying that she was disappointed in herself or whatever, Father Lamont says, "Sharon, your hunger for belief was your truth." And I'm like, what? Who cares?
I chose evil. And he gives her the whole Nomine Patri Filii Spiritus Sancti,
yeah,
which tells me that he is a boondock saint.
That's the sequel.
That's
Richard Burton. Yes, Richard Burton and Linda Blair start assassinating people.
This guy's killing all the killers. The house is utterly destroyed, but they could probably still easily get $500,000 for that property.
Right.
Because it's in the middle of D.C.
Yeah, in this market, sure.
Yeah.
But then, okay, and then the ending is basically Nurse Ratched makes it too, and she's just like, Regan is yours now, Father.
You have to take care of her.
What?
And then sends her on her way. Credits.
That's wild. She's yours now.
And I don't think we ever see Regan again until the television show.
Oh, really?
Played by Gina Davis.
Oh, well, that's interesting. I didn't even know there was a TV show.
Yeah, it was. I think I had like 2 seasons a couple years back. I actually watched most of the first season. It was, pretty good. But I think it retconned like the anything past number 3.
Yeah, and I mean she was already
in those 2 part 4s that came.
And I mean she was already replaced with Emily Rose. So like, what are we even doing here?
Right. So.
That's a coming soon. We could probably do too.
Goes out of here. As the notes get crumpled, I pose the question to you.
Yes.
Is this worth a watch? A drunk watch with friends, you attempting head trauma to forget it, or avoiding like the Egyptian plagues?
It's so weird because this movie, we both talked about it, and it's, you listen to what we talked about and you think, wow, this sounds crazy. And this sounds like a blast to watch because it's so weird and wild and like they got all these great actors for it. And like, it's very ambitious, right? I think we could both agree it's ambitious.
Oh, yeah. They definitely
took a swing.
They took some swings. Wild swinging for the fences swings.
Wild swings. And sometimes like a lot of times I appreciate that more than just like doing a sequel, like a cash-in sequel, and just kind of doing it. Apparently, the director, John Boorman, of this movie was like, he hated The Exorcist, which is like, why would you give that guy the sequel?
Right?
But anyway, having said all that, it's incredibly slow. It's so boring, and there's almost nothing to this movie. It's got the reputation of one of the worst sequels of all time for a reason. And I have to say avoid like the plague because I don't see a reason to really watch this all the way through. If you're morbidly curious, sure, but it's rough. What about you?
Yeah, I'm probably going to go ahead with avoid like the plague as well. There's not enough interesting stuff going on in the first 3/4 of the movie.
Yeah.
To make it worth it. If even, I don't know, half the energy that we were getting in the last act of this movie was on display in the first 3/4 of it, then you got something. But it's so dry and drags in so many spots in the lead up to this, to the exorcism that they do at the end of the movie, that it's not worth it. If you can manage to find the last, I don't know what, 20 minutes, half hour of the movie, on YouTube, just, listen to our podcast, stop when we start talking about it, watch it, and then you'll have a pretty good time. But other than that, avoid like the plague.
And just as a bonus, we don't usually do this, but I just want to read you a little snippet of the director of the first movie, William Friedkin, actually was asked about this movie at some point. And he said, I was at Technicolor and a guy said, we just finished a print of Exorcist II. Do you want to have a look at it? And I looked at half an hour of it and I thought it was as bad as seeing a traffic accident in the street. It was horrible. It's just a stupid mess made by a dumb guy, John Boorman by name, somebody who should be nameless, but in this case should be named. Scurrilous, a horrible picture, the worst piece of crap I've ever seen, a freaking disgrace. He later added, that film was made by a demented mind. So there you go.
Tell us how you really feel.
The director of the first movie, who, in his to his credit, also directed like The French Connection and shit. Like, William Friedkin's a great director, so it's not just him being like catty about it. Like, legitimately think he did not enjoy it.
Okay, well there you go, guys. We've had our talk. We are going to we're gonna pay some bills, but don't go anywhere because we will be right back.
What were they thinking?
Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.
Right, NPR bot, please process NPR protocol.
NPR mode activated. Your mother sucks cocks in hell. Jesus.
I don't know why he leads. We didn't even...
That's the first movie?
That's the first one.
We didn't even
talk about that.
Which,
one.
Spoiler alert, Nathan, will never be on this podcast.
No. Legitimately great movie.
A classic.
If you'll pardon NPR bot's salty language,
please.
We've come to the point where we will flex our poetic muscle in the great Eastern style of the haiku in a section we like to call the low haiku. Brennan, if you would be so kind as to let the folks know at home, just in case this might be their first episode, is what the low haiku is all about.
Yes, well, the low haiku, much like a regular inferior haiku, I would say, is 17 perfect syllables, 5, and then 7, and then 5 again, to describe the movie we just spent a lot more than 17 syllables breaking down.
Okay. And as I was the plot driver on this particular episode, would you like to lead us off with your low haiku?
I would. Folks love Exorcist. So here's the basic idea. We do not do that.
Very good.
Thank
very
you.
Good,
very Thank good. You.
Okay.
Thank you. And you have a haiku for us as well?
Yes, yes. Mine is as such.
Okay.
Flight of the locust. Really a horrid demon. Pazuzu petals.
I wanted to bring it back to the adventures of Fort Fairlane. And so with that all taken care of, NPR bot, please initiate exit protocol.
Beep, boop, hell.
Well, second one was a little more reserved than the first one.
At least he shortened it, I guess. NPR bot's getting a real attitude.
I don't know. You know, you give something some AI, next thing you know, it's sentient and swearing and not listening to you, not cleaning up its room or doing its laundry.
I'm not a kid anymore.
Sure, whatever.
Okay.
Anyhow.
Yeah.
So I mean, we've had our fun. We've had our poems.
Yes.
And we've had our say on this movie, but. Mm. We don't want you guys to think that we are, you know, we're the be-all and end-all of authority when it comes to, you know, if this was a good movie or not. So much so that we have a neat little saying that we like to use to remind you all of that. And what is that neat little saying, Brendan?
Well, that saying goes a little something like this.
Don't take a word for it!
That's right. Don't take our word for it. I mean, this movie, as we said, was the follow-up to a very popular, legitimately great movie. So I mean, the critics must have loved it because they love sequels.
Oh yeah, everyone was gaga about this movie. Despite making double its money back off a $14 million budget. Only 10% of the critics thought it was, halfway decent out of 62 reviews.
Oh, well, I mean, okay, that's fair. It's a horror movie, though, but so a horror movie, I mean, that's got a whole community horror movies do. I mean, they'll love just about anything. Look at Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Then they must have loved, the audience must love this movie.
Well, Nathan, this might be the closest consensus we've ever had between critics and audience, because only 13% of the audience liked it. 25,000 plus ratings.
Yikes.
But I will tell you, Nathan, that if you liked this movie, of which we both did not, you might also like Ghoulies.
I did.
That probably has to be a coming soon. By the way, I don't think there's a shot of a ghoulie coming out of a toilet. That is false advertising. I don't think it happens. I'll say it.
It happens in the second one, I think.
Oh, maybe, but I think it's on the first movie first one's poster, so. The other one is you might also like Cat's Eye.
I do.
Wolves at the Door.
Okay.
Spell. And Parasite, not the Oscar-winning film. One that seems to be presented in 3D. Yeah. So, that having been said, I guess we should take a look and see what the critics are saying about this movie. I'll start off with Tim Radford of The Guardian, who says, Richard Burton potters through it with a look of weary distaste or even nausea.
Vincent Canby of The New York Times says, there had to be a sequel, but did it have to be this desperate concoction? The main thrust of which is that the original exorcism wasn't all it was cracked up to be.
All right, well, I'm going to read a positive review here from David Peary of Time Out. The theme is attacked with engaging intensity, and Boorman brings off more than one visual coup, notably the ingenious locust photography in the African sequences. Dennis Wheatley fans at least will love it. Don't know the reference there, but maybe he's the cinematographer. I'm not sure. I'm sorry, film fans. I don't know.
Rex Reed of the New York Daily News. Yeah, he writes, this is a movie for morons, a total cheesy ripoff that makes not 1 minute of coherent sense. The script, direction, camera work, and sets are the work of cretins.
I mean, he's not wrong, but he's still the worst. Okay, Joe Pollock of the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, he's a top critic, says, sequels usually are not as good as the original motion picture, but they're not usually as bad as Exorcist II, The Heretic, which is, in a word, atrocious.
Okay. my next one comes from what was apparently a young Gene Siskel at the time.
Oh, boy.
From the Chicago Tribune.
He loved it.
And he writes, Exorcist 2 is the worst major motion picture I've seen in almost 8 years on the job.
Wow. Wow, that is something. And he saw everything. Okay, my last one is going to be from Joe Baltake, I think, from the Philadelphia okay. Daily News. And he says, it's either the biggest disaster ever recorded on celluloid or else the wildest, most radical spoof ever made by a major director. One thing is certain, though, the movie can't be ignored.
Okay. Well, I guess old Ken weighed in on this at one point because I've got one from Ken Hankey of the Mountain Express out of Asheville, North Carolina. And he gave it a positive review and writes, one fascinating disaster, an anti-Exorcist sequel from a filmmaker openly contemptuous of the original. 4 out of 5.
Oh, wow.
Wow, Ken, man. Seldomly we are on opposite of pages, but man, oh man.
I mean, it's wild to me. It's like that new Marilyn Monroe movie where the director openly was like, oh, I don't have much respect for her film career. It's like, why are you making a Marilyn Monroe movie, you fucking idiot? And it paid off because that movie is terrible. Okay, let's go to the audience. Let's go to the audience. Reviews. My first review is from Horse Tears. Horse Tears gives this movie 5 stars.
Yeek.
Possibly better than the first one.
Whoa.
A surreal influence runs through the film, highlighting what the first one didn't explore, Reagan's point of view. He spells it like the president.
Isn't that how it's spelled?
No, I think there's just an R-E-G, whereas I think president is R-E-A-G.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Imagine if Ronald Reagan had been in this movie instead.
Well,
where's my mommy? She didn't want to be in school.
Anyhow, my first one tonight, it's a short one, but it's a confusing one.
Okay.
It's from Rodrigo C. He didn't care for it, and he writes, a deception has a sequel. 0.5 star.
What? The first one is a deception. I think maybe he just discovered what a movie was for the first time. Like a fictional film. I thought it was real. Okay, well, Benjamin H. gives it 2.5 stars and just says, accidentally clicked. I don't think he meant to leave the review. But you know what?
He just couldn't hit the back browser on his button. Back button on his browser, rather.
Couldn't hit back, couldn't hit delete. Nope, just accidentally.
I guess I got to give it a review and then a star rating. Oh my god. Let's see if I could. I know there's not many of them, so let's see if I can find a somewhat positive one. Ooh, wow. I'm going with this name it's a positive review. It's from T Spice Bush Swallowtail R.
I knew as soon as you laughed at the name, I was like, it's gotta be that person.
The Heretic, I think they were trying to go for an italicized text here, but writes, The Heretic is a severely underrated gem. It may be the best quote-unquote bad film lemmings love to hate. It's well shot, the effects are cool, and the subconsciousness slash hypnosis material is really fascinating, to say the least. Don't be fooled by the naysayers. This is a damn good film. 4 out of stars.
Sorry, Mr. Mrs. Whoever, Swallowtail.
Swallowtail R.
Incorrect.
Okay, this one is from John R., spelt, of course, J-O-N-N, as you do. 4 stars.
Last name, Buckle. John R.
John R. Buckle. Yeah, R is the middle initial. 4 stars. I actually love this movie. There are plenty of very bad things about it. Acting, story, pseudoscience, sets. But they all add up to a very weird experience. The movie makes no normal logical sense, but instead follows a fever dream logic. Just let it wash over you. Like Teletubbies, it is oddly satisfying from this point of view. I don't know if I've ever described Teletubbies as oddly satisfying. When I had to watch it every single day while my mom had to babysit my niece. I don't know if I was oddly satisfied by Teletubbies.
Or insanely enraged.
Oh, man.
My next one comes from Ted W., who I can only imagine has some anger issues, possibly.
All right.
Or just a super high bar of things that are good. Because old Ted here writes, terrible sequel to a terrible movie.
Come on.
That's patently false. I mean, it's not, but it is.
Yeah.
He gave this movie a half out of star.
All right, my last review comes from Brittany S. Brittany, I'm
Brittany
assuming...
Brittany Spears?
Oh, I was going to say, I'm assuming former guest Brittany Sparrow.
Oh, okay.
And also Brittany Spears. They co-wrote it. 5 stars. Amazing how they make you seem like you're a part of it. That's it. I don't know what that
means.
Are you
talking about, like, the point of view shots where like you could like see where the locusts were flying
guess,
and stuff.
I guess they were just really impressed with those POV camera shots.
Okay, well, not to be outdone, my last one comes from one Vincent P. Now I can only assume that's Vincent Price.
Oh.
And he writes, one completely batshit superhero origin tale where it trimmed of some of the filmmaker's attempts at making it more art house type fare, read pretentious and unnecessary segments. It might be more easily comprehensible. It's not without its moments, though. This is just a weird instance where I wish WB had stepped up and tinkered in. The score by Morricone, though, absolutely beautiful. Yeah.
Every time I hear Vincent Price's voice, by the way, and I know this is not even close to his most famous work, but I just think of him in The Great Mouse Detective.
As Rat again.
Oh, I love it. I watched that a million times when I was younger.
It's a pretty great little often overlooked Disney gem.
A very underrated movie. I agree.
So there we go. That's what the critics and the audience had to say. So now we're done talking about this movie. We're going to move on and we're going to talk about stuff that we enjoyed watching in the latest dance craze sensation that's sweeping the nation. It's what you watching, bud?
What you watching, bud? I don't know what you watching, bud. I'll tell you so.
So, Brendan,
hmm.
Or as Coog called you earlier on Facebook, Brandon.
Did he actually? I missed that.
No, he was messaging.
Oh.
He uses voice to text.
Oh.
So it said Brandon. I was like, I'm telling him you called him Brandon. All that aside, what you watching, bud?
What am I watching? Well, I am, again, watching a lot of horror this month. So I'm going to recommend another little horror slash comedy venture. I watched this. Just to preface this, I don't like a lot of trauma stuff. Like the stuff that I've seen is mostly new shit. A couple of old ones, like I've seen, you know, the Beware Children at Play. I think, is that what it's called? Where the kids are all like gunned down at some point.
They're murdery kids.
Yeah, and that one's like whatever. But like. I've seen the modern ones don't really do anything for me, but I finally watched the first Toxic Avenger movie, and boy howdy, that was a trashster piece. I loved every single second of it. Now, don't get me wrong, it is
an inexplicably bad taste. Like almost every frame of that movie is tasteless as fuck. But you kind of have to just watch it for what it is.
That's trauma, man.
It's trauma. And you kind of just have to watch. And if you're not familiar with trauma, like, I'm just letting you know their stuff. So you kind of just have to watch it as it is. And, I mean, if you want to see, you know, a little nerdy guy become a big, tough superhero, kind of, and then, you know, dance around with a blind girl, you know, that's all I want in my movies. It's literally every second of that movie, something unexpected. I didn't expect there to be child murder in the first 10 minutes. The villains literally just run people over randomly. And
it's trauma, man. Yeah.
Again, I haven't seen a lot of trauma stuff, but even then, like, you know, it doesn't happen a lot in movies. You don't see that stuff like that quite a bit. So yeah, The Toxic Avenger, check it out. It's crazy. What about you? Which watch?
Well, I took in a new addition to Disney Plus. It may not be the greatest horror movie ever made, but I liked it for what it was and all of its moving parts, as they say. Grimcuddy. I'm sure there's probably people are going to be divisive about it because it does rely on a lot of jump scares. There is a bit of gore in it, but it's kind of an interesting take on it's almost like a mashup of Slenderman and Momo.
As good as Slenderman?
I would rather watch this than Slenderman at least five more times before I watch. But Grimcuddy is again, it's a kind of a mashup of Slenderman and the Momo, creepypasta internet meme thing. It's got the villain has kind of an intriguing power that you find out, that you figure out through a twist. So I'm not going to spoil that. It is on Disney Plus here in Canada. I'm assuming that it's on Hulu or Star in the States. So, I mean, if you have any of those services, it's not going to cost you anything except your monthly subscription to check it out. So, you know, see if you concur or if I am just a drunken lunatic making no sense whatsoever. Grimcuddy.
Beautifully worded.
Thank you.
But Nathan, speaking of beautiful words. Does your friend Montrose want to say some beautifully worded prose of his own?
Sure. So one moment, I'll get him. Hello, it's good friend Montrose Monkington III here, and I would just like to invite you to my YouTube channel, Montrose Monkington TV, where I have recently covered the Extreme Rules of the WWE, and was rather pleased that it wasn't the Extreme Following of Rules, which they have done in the past. Despite maybe one or two missteps along the way in the evening, I found it to be a rather enjoyable pay-per-view. What did the Banana Bunch? Steve Dusod was there to review it with me. You can find that, as I said, on my the YouTube channel, Montrose Monkington TV. You can be friends with me on the Facebook group, Montrose Monkington III Esquire and Friends. I also post my videos there. And then you can also tweet at me on your Twitter devices, at Montrose III. That's the number 3 RD. Thank you. More later. Yeah.
Thank you, Montrose.
You're welcome.
And of course, you can find us all over the place. We're on all the podcast apps. Our home base, though, is Age of Radio.
Big time!
And you can find us anywhere else just by searching for What Were They Thinking. We're on Facebook. Check us out there. Check us out on Twitter and Instagram at WWTT Podcast, Redbubble, TeePublic, Patreon.com/WWTT Podcast. Check us out there. This month, there is a bonus episode up or soon to be up whenever this airs. Calendars are not my friend. But this month, there will be an episode on Critters 2, and that is exclusive to Patreon. So make sure to jump on board there and check that out. But other than that, that's pretty much all I got. So I guess I'll just close this out by asking you, some questions about Exorcist II, the Heretic.
Heretic, not the Heretic.
Not the Heretic.
Yeah. All right, well, since I did watch it once in a sleep-deprived state in the late 80s, I guess I'm the subject expert here. Please, fire away.
You would be the expert. Well, okay, so in a movie wherein you take the first movie and you say, let's get a director who didn't really like it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And in a movie in which you just invent this science of brain syncing or dream syncing.
Right.
In a movie in which, I don't want to say even Ellen Burstyn, because I mean, I think she's a great actress, but, you know, Ellen Burstyn is like, no, 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 thank you.
Right.
But they
did get Richard Burton and Nurse Ratched.
And you somehow managed to convince Max von Sydow to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But and in a movie in which you have everything happen in the last 10, 15 minutes.
Right.
I mean, and you made a sequel to The Exorcist that didn't need to happen. I just got to know.
What's that?
What were they thinking?
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his face. Pleased to meet you, hope you guess my name. But what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. Stuck around St. Petersburg when I saw it was a time for a change. Killed the Tsar and its ministers. Anastasia screamed in vain. I rode a tank, held a generous rank. When the blitzkrieg raged and the bodies stank. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name. Oh yeah.